want to play another game. And a bunch of you told me you failed at all of the different things. We had a great time. We were on a retreat, and we found out even some other things that Pastor Jay did. Besides being a door-to-door meat salesman, he had some other interesting jobs that came out when he was trying to just make ends meet between college and the rest of his life. And so the game we're going to play today is called Name That Tune, all right? We're going to hear just a few bars of this song, and the first hand that goes up, I want you to put your hand up if you know what song this is. You ready? Here we go. Nine to five. Bonus question. Who sung that song? Dolly Parton. All right, let's hear the rest of this, just the beginning of this song. Listen to this. Jump in the shower and the blood starts pumping. Out on the streets, the traffic starts jumping with folks like me on the job from 9 to 5. Working 9 to 5. What a way to make a living. Barely getting by. It's all taking and no giving. They just use your mind and they never give you credit. It's enough to drive you crazy if you let it.
All right, all right. Well, man, it's just crazy how we know these songs. You're like, I never listened to country music, and yet I know that song.
You are humming every word of that song. And this is the thing that we're trying to understand, because the world looks at work one way. And as we've been going through the book of Ephesians, verse by verse, we got to this place, Ephesians chapter 6, verse 5 to 9, and we considered bondservants and masters and our own work. In this third week here today, last week we talked about a theology of work, and this week we are going to consider this theme, this idea of work as worship, work as worship. You know, for most of us in the world, when we don't have a correct view of what God has designed for work, we can get into these moments where we act or feel like Dolly Parton is singing. What's the point of this? 9 to 5, I come home, this is all that I'm going to do, and yet we want to have a different view as we're followers of Christ, that we do all things for the glory of God, and we want to live a life where there is no secular and sacred, where everything is together, where we don't parse out the everyday and the divine, where we don't divide our work and our service to God, but we live every moment as unto the Lord, glorifying God. Even as we have students here, you know, Elijah was baptized, and Elijah's goal in life is to honor the Lord in all that he does. If he's in school, or if he's working, if he's at home, whether he's out with his friends, in all things we give glory to God. And this would be this idea where our work can be worship to God as well. Each of you who work in the marketplace, you do your work, and if you're a follower of Jesus, then your work is supposed to be to the glory of God. You have opportunities every day to represent Christ, to be a witness, to be different. We're going to study a portion of Scripture. We've got two different portions of Scripture we're going to study, but one of them in John chapter 4, Jesus says that the food that satisfies, the food that he wants to eat, is to do the will of God, and it is the work of God that he is talking about. And so the title of the message today is Work as Worship. But first, let's consider our attitude as we work for the Lord. Work as worship is work for God, not yourself. Be thankful. Work for God, not yourself. Be thankful. What kind of attitude do you have as you approach your work life? Wherever you're working, if you're working in streets and sanitation in the city of Chicago, if you're a police officer, a firefighter, if you're a pastor, if you're a doctor, if you're an attorney, if you represent people on the mission field, if you're in advertising, in marketing, whatever you do, do you live your life with an attitude of thankfulness? Thankfulness that you have a job, thankfulness that you have an ability. Last week we talked about able men given abilities to do different things, and we have seen that so clearly in our own lives as well. Are you thankful? What kind of attitude do you have when somebody else gets a promotion and you're passed up for it? When your boss takes credit for something that now he's getting accolades for that you had done, what is your attitude? Do you even have an attitude of thankfulness as you go about your work? Because things can be unfair in work. Would you agree with that? Would you agree that even the world is unfair at times? And so what is our attitude? Well, Jesus teaches a great principle here. I'm not going to unpack it like I normally would, you know, just taking a lot of time in it. But in Matthew chapter 20, we have a parable. And the title of the parable in my ESV translation says, Laborers in the Vineyard. I think it's a good title for it. But there's another theme that comes through here in this parable that's found in Matthew chapter 20. You can turn there and follow along. A parable, for those of you that are new to church, if you've never been here before, never set foot in a church, a parable is just a made-up story with a theological principle, a principle to try to help us to understand what God is like, what the kingdom of heaven is like, and how our what our response is supposed to be here on earth. Matthew chapter 20 says this, Jesus speaking and teaching, for the kingdom of heaven, see, he's now going to teach what the kingdom of heaven is like. The kingdom of heaven is like a master of a house who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. After agreeing with the laborers for a denarius a day, he sent them into his vineyard. A denarius, a day's wage, this is fair. If you're going to work for a day and you got a denarius, you'd be very thankful. I got my day's wage. This is the only group, as we go through this parable, that actually is given an amount of how much they're going to agree to work. Let's continue. And going out about the third hour, he saw others standing idle in the marketplace. And to them, he said, you go into the vineyard too, and whatever is right, whatever is fair, I will give you. So they went. Going out again about the sixth hour and the ninth hour, he did the same. And about the 11th hour, he went out and found others standing. And he said to them, why do you stand here idle all day? They said to him, because no one has hired us. He said to them, you go into the vineyard too. And when evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his foreman, call the laborers who pay them their wages, beginning with the last up to the first. And when those hired about the 11th hour came, each of them received a denarius. The people who came just with 1 hour left to work, they got a denarius. Now, those who hired first came, they thought they would receive more, but each of them also received a denarius, and on receiving it, they grumbled at the master of the house, saying, these last worked only 1 hour, and you have made them equal to us who have borne the burden of the day and the scorching heat. But he replied to one of them, friend, I am doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for a denarius? Take what belongs to you and go. I choose to give to this lax worker as I give to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Or do you begrudge my generosity? So the last will be first and the first last. That's a parable that we're probably familiar with if you've grown up in the church. And at first glance, this would seem unfair to the person who has worked all day long. Think about the hours it would have been in the scorching heat working and agreeing to denarius, and then somebody comes at the last hour. This person doesn't know what the master has said to the people that are standing out there at 7-Eleven waiting for a person to come pick them up, or at Home Depot. We've seen it in different places where a day laborer will be waiting for a job. They don't know as they're working out there what this master has said to these people that are working. And we see the graciousness of this master, this owner of this vineyard, who is God in the parable. And the vineyard would be, throughout the scripture, we see the vineyard as a picture of the people of Israel. And so the kingdom of heaven is compared to this group of people who are out there working, and God is not fair. God is not fair in what he does and how he treats us. I know that's a provocative statement for many, but just think about this person here. They agreed to a denarius to work for a whole day, and that's a fair work. The person who's coming at the 11th hour, they don't know what they're going to expect, maybe 1/10 or 1/12 of a denarius, and that would have been fair, but God is not fair. He treats us in ways that are beyond our imagination with his generosity. But the first workers, they got what they were promised, and they're upset. Their attitude is not right. They're not thankful. They're looking at somebody else and saying, I should have gotten more, or they should have gotten less. This game of comparison in our workplace can make us be people who have a different attitude. And are you thankful today? What kind of attitude do you have as you work for the Lord? Be thankful. Instead of being thankfulness, they have different expectations. Maybe the first response could have been, thank you for giving me what I agreed to. I just have a question for you. Is there any way that I could get maybe a little bit more because I've worked longer? But they go right at it. Shouldn't they have gotten less? This isn't fair. I've worked in this way and I'm not getting what I deserve. See, the point of the passage here is God does not treat us as we deserve. Do you agree with that or disagree? Do you agree or disagree? God does not treat us as we deserve. And in the world, we want it always to be fair. And aren't you thankful that God does not treat us as we deserve? Aren't you thankful today that God was not fair with us in our own sinfulness, but he had justice and he used Jesus' death on the cross to give us what we didn't deserve. He gave us something even more. I'm so thankful that God is not fair. In our response as we work, we acknowledge that there's a difference sometimes between how we're treated and we can be thankful. We can be thankful. This is the heart attitude of somebody who is glorifying the Lord. How thankful are you at work? How thankful are you today that you have a job? There's some, we're going to have an opportunity, as we said, it's very applicational these 3 weeks. We're going to have an opportunity at the end of our service for some of you who want help, who need a job, who need some help with trying to ask your boss for a raise. We're going to have some coaching available. We had 40 people who are business owners and leaders in our community who said we're willing to help. And so we're going to have opportunities to connect you all. What is your response? Are you thankful, those of you that are working? Here's a quote from a theologian, Abraham Kuyper. Now, I don't agree with everything that he teaches, but I thought that this was very thoughtful here. Whatever man may stand, whatever he may do, to whatever he may apply his hand, in agriculture, in commerce, and in industry, or his mind, in the world of art and science, he is, in whatsoever it may be, constantly standing before the face of God. He is employed in the service of his God. He has strictly to obey his God, and above all, he has to aim at the glory of his God. What a great posture for all of us to have here today, to be thankful people, to have as our great purpose in life the glory of God alone. To, as he says here, to work as if you're working before the very face of God. What would it be like for you as you go to whatever workplace that you have, as you stepped into this 9-to-5 job this week, and as you entered in and you had this attitude that I am going to be thankful today. I'm going to be thankful. Now, that doesn't mean that you have to be trampled over. Again, as we are in workplaces, we're not working in our workplaces as such for our direct boss, God. We do have other bosses, and so you can appeal to whatever systems are in place to advocate for fairness, to advocate for justice. But as you do those things, there may be an opportunity or a need for you one day to say, I need to move on from here because this is too much for me. I can't continue in this place or this pace, and I need to get out. And that's okay too. Prayerfully consider that. Get some counsel before you make any drastic moves. But we want to be thankful people. Our work is worship. Be thankful for your work opportunities. Well, let's continue the output, the way that we work. Second, I would like us to consider the quality of our work. Do work for God. Make good tables. Do work for God. Be thankful. Make good tables. Quality. Do good work for God. In 1 Corinthians 10:31, Paul says this, so whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do all to the glory of God. All things for God's glory. If you work, are you working for the glory of God? I would suggest to you that those of you with a deep relationship with Jesus, if you were doing something for God and you could physically see God there, your attitude would be different. The time you took would be different. The way that you finish it would be different. I want you to be people who do good work for God. All things are for God's glory. In my work here at the church, I try to work hard. I want to do it with excellence. It's not perfect, and none of us are perfect, but we strive to make things better. That's why we talk about things in between the services or after the weekend is finished so that we can do it a little bit better. Let's figure out how we can correct some of the things that we had done or the ways that it may not have gone right. At the end of an event, we talk about things. How did people feel when they came in? How was the food flow at this conference? What can we do different to make it better? Because we want to do all things for the glory of God. Nobody gets yelled at. Nobody gets fired. But we always want to do better for God's glory. Do your work for the glory of God. Growing up in my house, there was not a lot of pressure on me. I've told you, I'm 11 years younger than my oldest brother, 7 years than my oldest sister. And by the time I came, they just let me do whatever I wanted to do. They were tired. My parents were old and tired, and they just said whatever. So I didn't have to make my bed. It was just like, there it was. They hardly made it down to my part of the house. And so I just did what I wanted to do. But when we got married, Susan, she grew up in a very different home where you make your bed, you do these things. And so when we got married, that was something I had to learn. I got to make my bed. One time, this is after I was here at church, and I made the bed, and Susan said this. It was very convicting to me. And I've changed since then. I hope it's better. She said, would you accept this at work that way, right? And I was like, you're right. You're right. You know, it should be, let's do it good. Do good work for God. All of the work that we do should be good work for God, including the work that we do. Do you know, I read some statistics, that we work 20% of our whole life is work. 90,000 hours of work. Just think about that for a moment. The amount of time you spend in your workplace. You spend more time with your coworkers if you work really closely with them than you do engaged in conversation with your children, probably, if you think about it during a week. There is so much time at work. You approach it with an attitude that it is for the glory of God, and do you try to do excellent work? The world would be much different if we worked with this attitude of everything for the glory of God. All that we are called to do, we do good work to the glory of God. I read this article many years ago. I think it was written in 1942 by Dorothy Sayers, and she writes this about work. There's a lot of thoughts on work, but one of the things she wrote just stuck out here in this idea of working here. The church's approach to an intelligent carpenter is usually confined to exhorting him, not to be drunk and disorderly in his leisure hours and to come to church on Sundays. What the church should be telling him is this, that the very first demand that his religion makes upon him is that he should make good tables. Of course, she doesn't minimize the fact, it's not confined to this, that you stop getting drunk and being out there in the world, but it's not just confined to that. Could the church also challenge and instruct a person who is working to make good tables? Make good tables to the glory of God. Holiness is right, but we should never just leave it at that. See, we'll compartmentalize things. If I stop drinking, if I stop swearing, if I stop looking at the things that I shouldn't be looking at, then everything is good. But I believe that our whole life should be submitted to the glory of God. So these things are important, but also make good tables. Be holy in your work. The legs should be on straight. They shouldn't be crooked. Right here we have a table that was made by a young man in our church. We have three of them like this, and we have two in the lobby. You'll see them. They're right out there when you go out. These are very heavy tables, especially those out there. He actually has a PhD now. He was studying at Moody, and in his spare time, he made tables. You'll see some chips and things on it. This is probably, 8 years old now. It probably could use a refinishing. But man, is it solid. He was out there over by this side of the building. He had his welding machine, and he was welding all those joints, and he made those tables perfect. Those tables out there, they're not rocking. These tables are so well made. And he was 23 years old when he was making these tables. He did it for the glory of God. Make good tables. I thought it would be great to just show you some of the work that people in our church do. I'm going to confess to you a frustration that I have when I go to restaurants. I sit at the table, and I put my elbow on the table, and what happens? The rocking. Oh, it's a frustration for me. Because if I owned the restaurant, or if I was the server, as soon as I set the table and I put that sheet on there, and I've had the candles and everything else on there, I would just give it a little touch. And then I would go and get something and put it under there. How many times, Susan, we've been out? Do you have something for this? You know, we try to fix it ourselves. We can't. Do you have a shim? Do you have some wood and a some wood and a saw, perhaps? I will go and make something so that this table doesn't shake because my water has been filled up to the top. Thank you, because you knew we looked thirsty, but now the whole table is wet and my bread is soaked, and it is a frustration that I have when I'm eating, because we should do everything to the glory of God. Let's set and make good tables. Whatever work you are doing, have a good attitude, thankfulness to God, and like Jesus, I want to make good tables. Be thankful, make good tables. Work as worship. This is a short message because we're going to hear some testimonies in a moment. On purpose, it's a short message. Third and finally, you're like, oh my gosh, I get used to this. When you're not going verse by verse, sometimes, you know, you can do a little things a little differently. Here we go. Work as worship. Quality, do good work for God, make good tables. And the final principle today regarding our mission as followers of Christ, on mission, do the work of God, eat real food. Do the work of God, eat real food. I've purposely chosen three things that we do when we are at a table. We're thankful to God when we pray. I was yesterday with the Trevinos, and something that Mike's dad said to me really stuck with me. And he said, when we pray, we should always be thinking about what we're praying. No casual prayers. And I thought that was really great. And right before I prayed for Elijah at this ceremony that we had, a rite of passage ceremony, so beautiful. Right before I prayed for him, I just paused. And I said, I want this to really matter to you, God. I'm thankful right now. And so no cursory prayers. We're thankful at a dinner table when we pray. That's part of our worship to God, giving thanks. But we sit at a table, and I hope that the table is made well, make good tables. And then we eat at a table. I want you to eat real food. The mission that we're called to, is to do the work of God. There's a passage of scripture, John chapter 4. In John chapter 4, we see Jesus, and he interacts with this woman at the well, this Samaritan. They're cutting through the Samaritan area, and the Samaritans and the Jewish people, they're kind of at odds. They have some different views. They're from the same place, and yet their views on religion and faith, they're similar, but they're different in some really important ways and aspects. And he has this interaction with this woman there at the well, John chapter 4. She comes to the well at a time when nobody else would be there because she's had many husbands already. And Jesus is there at the right time. He interacts with this outcast, and as he interacts with this outcast, finally she sees that Jesus is the Messiah, and she puts her faith in him, and she runs back to her village to tell everybody. It's an awesome story. I've preached a whole message on this before, John chapter 4, this remarkable woman of great faith, this outcast who everybody in the village was judging, she meets Jesus, the Messiah, and she tells everybody about it. Well, part of the context of this is he's there alone at the well because the disciples have gone to go get food because they didn't have any food to eat. And while they're gone, he has this interaction with this woman, this sinful woman at the well. Jesus is alone there. When the disciples return and they want him to eat, this is what happens here. This is the context of it. John chapter 4, verse 31. Meanwhile, the disciples were urging him, saying, Rabbi, eat. They've just come back with this food. Rabbi, eat. But he said to them, I have food to eat that you do not know about. So the disciples said to one another, has anyone brought him something to eat? I just love when the Bible has like the funny things that happened with Jesus recorded. They go to get some food because Jesus, you know, they want to feed him. They come back and he says, I have food that you don't know about. Why'd we go to the store then? You got your protein bars. Where were they? You know, under the tunic, I didn't see it. You know, Peter probably like, who was it? Which one of you did this and got Jesus the food that I was supposed to bring to Jesus, right? You just picture it and they're confused because Jesus is talking in a mysterious way. I have food that you do not know about. What would you have felt, husbands or wives? You're at home and you're hungry. Let's just say wives for a moment. Wife is pregnant, you know, has a craving for Portillo's chicken salad and says, husband, would you just go and get me a Portillo's chicken salad? Husband's like, sure, anything. You're doing the hard work. I'm going to go. And leaves and goes and gets the salad and comes back, walks in, puts that plastic bowl right there, even takes the dressing out and gives it a shake and puts it on the table. And she says, I have food that you don't know about. This must be the pregnancy. Why would you send me out if you have food that I didn't know about? And Jesus, of course, is speaking in a mystery to them. And he goes on to say what it is that he's talking about. Jesus said to them, my food is to do the will of him who sent me and to accomplish his work. The food that satisfies Jesus is to do the will of God. Eat real food as you are working, as you are living, as you are loving, as you're relating. Eat real food. Do the will of God. That would be your holiness. That would be your submission to his will for you to do excellent work. That would be for you to fulfill his will for you to be an able man or an able woman with an ability, as we studied last week, to do what God has asked you to do. See, Jesus is so satisfied. He's forgot about his thirst. He was thirsty and got some water. He was hungry and got some food, but he is sitting so satisfied there because the will of God was satisfying for him. Eat real food. Do the will of God. Do the work that God has called you to do. And the work that God has called you to do ultimately is to do the mission of God. To be on mission for God, wherever you are, in whatever place that you are working, are you satisfied in doing the will of God? Here's the way I wrote it down. Doing the will of God by joining in the work of God is my food from God. Of course, you're going to eat and drink and try to satisfy the natural needs that you have, but are you satisfied first and foremost with this, that I am on mission for God, doing the will of God, doing the work of God? This is what we're called to, church. This is what should be satisfying you as you are in the marketplace, as you are working and serving. Verse 35 says, do you not say there are yet 4 months, then comes the harvest? Look, I tell you, lift up your eyes and see that the fields are white for harvest. Already the one who reaps is receiving wages and gathering fruit for eternal life, so that sower and reaper may rejoice together. For here the saying holds true, one sows and another reaps. I sent you to reap that for which you did not labor. Others have labored, and you have entered into their labor. Jesus is pointing to how things work in the world. There's a season for sowing, and there's a season for reaping. There's a season for planting. There's a season for harvesting. That's the way the world works. But in the kingdom of God, there is sowing and reaping, harvesting and planting going on at the same time. You may be sowing, another may be reaping. You may have just sowed it yesterday, and they meet another person, and the reaping happens. And he looks and sees, you can picture it. Here, the woman goes to the village. She tells the village runs out to see the Messiah. He says, look, the fields are white to harvest. I could imagine him pointing to the people that are coming and the dust that's picking up behind them as the village comes towards Jesus. And he says, look up. The fields are white for harvest. The time to harvest is right now. Jesus is pointing to what should come. Look, I tell you, lift up your eyes and see that the fields are white for harvest. The one who reaps is receiving wages. I sent you to reap that for which you did not labor. Interesting. What an interesting phrase that he says. Others have labored and you have entered into their labor. I want you to hear this. I know you're like, you've been here a long time, Pastor. Yeah, I've been here for a while. Been here 16 years, almost 17 years. I didn't start this. I entered into somebody else's labor. And some people here who've been here since the beginning, they're like, exactly. You didn't start this. We did. No, you didn't either. You entered into somebody else's labor. See, God has been sowing since the beginning. And every person that has ever started any even groundbreaking work, Billy and Jen going to Africa to start really this groundbreaking work, they didn't start it either. They entered into somebody else's work. And so we can be assured that the work we do is the work of God. God establishes it. God sanctifies it. God changes us and helps us to bear this fruit. Look at all these words of laboring and working and sowing and reaping. See, it is on the heart of God that we work. And the work that God wants for us to do is the mission of God. In every aspect of our life, we work as worship. Verse 39, many Samaritans from that town believed in him because of the woman's testimony. He told me all that I ever did. So when the Samaritans came to him, they asked him to stay with him. And he stayed there 2 days. And many more believed because of his word. They said to the woman, it is no longer because of what you said that we believe, for we have heard for ourselves, and we know that this is indeed the Savior of the world. This account ends with this huge harvest that comes. Many more believed because of the testimony of this woman, because Jesus did the will of God, because Jesus was satisfied in the food of God. Be on mission for God. Do the work of God. Eat real food. Food that satisfies. How are you engaging in the labor of the Lord? Is it more of a burden for you every week? It is. We talked about that last week. It is toil. It is by sweat, through thorns and thistles that we work. And yet we're called to do it for the glory of God. This is the means that we have to approach our work as worship. God has given it to us. Let's be thankful. Let's make good tables. And let's eat real food and do the work that God has for us. Just a moment, we're going to hear from two people in our church who have some things they want to share with you, some testimonies. We put it out there and we heard back from some of you. And so we're going to hear from them in a moment. But just watch this short video on work as worship.
Work. Most of us spend over half our lives at work. Whatever it is you fill the 9-to-5 with, planting crops, building cars, taking care of patients, teaching students, or running a business, work is where most of life happens. For some, work is a drain. They dread Monday mornings, forcing themselves to struggle through because they need the paycheck, while many times feeling trapped and beaten down by their job. Some people love their work. They're good at what they do. It energizes them. It's a place of security, a place to chase dreams, desires, and success. At work, they find fulfillment. We often forget to connect our faith to our work. We don't consider the reasons God may have us at our job. We don't think about the purpose and meaning we could bring to our work. We simply focus on how it makes us feel. But what if we saw our work as an opportunity to worship? As Christians, we are called to serve Christ with our lives. For a few, that means working as a pastor, a youth minister, or a missionary. Others serve the church by teaching children or singing in the choir. But when Sunday is over, most of us return to our jobs outside the church. For us, our mission is in the marketplace. We may not be the kind of missionary who moves to the far regions of Africa, but around the conference table, around the water cooler, around the cubicle, we have an opportunity to worship the God who created us. He gave us skill. He gave us passion. He gave us work. When we do our jobs with excellence and integrity and diligence, it's an act of worship. We are displaying God's craftsmanship to the non-believing world around us. We are earning the right to be heard. We don't see a divide between Sunday and Monday, between the sacred and the secular. We've been invited into parts of the world that a pastor or traditional missionary will never see. We have conversations with people who had never set foot in a church. Whether we love or dread our work, we choose to turn the focus away from ourselves and toward the mission God has for us. Church is not the only place we worship, and Sundays are not the only days on our calendars that have meaning. Every day on Mission for God brings us great joy. Like the heroes before us, we can be modern-day Noahs and Josephs and Peters who are called with a purpose. God has designed us. He created us to work and to worship. For us, work is worship.
All right. Well, we have an opportunity today to hear from two people in our church, and they both are working, and they've got some things that they want to share. I thought their stories were really cool. But we're going to put a number up. The first is Peter Rios. We'll see him in just a moment. But we're going to put a number up in just a moment. And this number is for those of you that want some help. You know, we've got some coaches together at the end of the service. If you need, like, immediate help, you just need prayer for something, the cafe is going to be open. We got some people that are going to be there ready to talk with you, to encourage you, to maybe answer a quick question. And we're going to also give an opportunity for you to text in to this number that's coming up here. We'll see it in a moment. You can just text work. If you just need some help, you want to talk about interviewing, you want to find if, do we have any resources for you to work, you want to talk about how to negotiate with your bosses, whatever it might be, any question you have about work, we've got people that would love to talk to you about it. All right, so go ahead and text at any time over the next 10 minutes as we hear from these guys about their stories. So first, Peter, come on up and just talk for a little bit. Just what do you do for a living?
So I work for original manufacturing company, OEM, and I'm the accounting manager for the company.
Okay, and so tell us a little bit about how God has impacted your view on work.
Well, that's not tough. He has impacted my view on work through showing me how he uses me at work and how work can provide not only for my family, but challenge me to be closer to him, challenge my character to become a better Christian and closer to him through things at work.
Okay. And you are not from this country originally, right?
Nope.
Yeah, so where are you from?
Guatemala.
Guatemala, yes. And we went there and served there, and we're just so thankful for your family and what they've done. But as we talked, you said that when you came to this country, you had some opportunity that was given mm-hmm. to you. So talk about that a little bit.
So I think that my journey at work has been impacted by God in four different ways, and it's favor, boldness, wisdom, and humbleness. And I came to this country with a contract of 6 months in this company, and 6 months have become 6.5 years. Yeah. And I have found favor with these people because I don't have the education, I don't have the background, I don't have every new opportunity they give to me, I have zero experience to do it. And somehow, God has given me favor and grace to, you know, find favor in front of him to give me the opportunity. So that's the favor part. Boldness is because every time they have given me the opportunity, I could have said no. And actually, one time I said no. Mm-hmm. But God has given me the peace and the boldness to say yes, knowing maybe 5% of what the role is. Yeah. I've been able to go at it. And then, obviously, just the wisdom on how to do the job and how to talk to people, how to be a Christian at my workplace and all those things. It's amazing how he has filled all the gaps, but also through humbleness. And then I want to quote my father-in-law that is sitting right there, because that guy is probably the smartest person and engineer I know. But every time you would laud him on, like, oh, this is great, or you did this amazing, he would say the same thing. He says, I'm not smart enough. He's smart enough.
All right, naturally.
He's actually smart enough. But he would say, I'm not smart enough, meaning I can't do this on my own.
Yeah.
You know, I have found the humbleness, which is something hard for me in Jesus, to learn, to listen, to ask the questions, and not try to come with a solution, which is kind of my first gut. But yeah. Sit back and listen and understand and then attack the problem or the situation, whatever
that
is.
That's great. Well, thank you, Peter, for sharing your story. And
You know, just take a chance sometimes. You know, there's an opportunity that comes. Put your name in. You know, you're like, hey, I think I do it, but I don't know if I got enough. Just take a chance. You know, be bold. I really love that you did that. And this here is Tommy Christian. And Tommy, what do you do for work?
I run a small business. We train athletes in sports performance and speed development.
All right, but that's not what you set out to start doing, right? So tell us, when we talked, I mean, his testimony of how God brought him out of what he was trained to do originally into this, I think was just remarkable. So just tell us a little bit about what were you supposed to be doing?
Yeah, I was supposed to be designing automobiles. I was a mechanical engineer, was working in the automotive industry, and I played football at Northwestern prior to that. But, you know, 2.5 years into my engineering career, I started to get these ideas of, you know, what would it be like if the goal of my work wasn't to make money for some automotive company, but really be in a place where God could use me to impact lives. And I thought, well, maybe I'll be a coach. And I thought, well, I don't really want to be a football coach because football coaches determine, like, who plays or who doesn't. And I thought about in my career or my life, like, the person with the biggest impact was my strength coach because it was just this mentoring, like, investing in athletes kind of relationship. And I thought, well, that would be really cool. And, like, my brother was playing the NFL at the time. And I, you know, I'd played in college. And I knew, like, what was available in terms of training. I thought this could be a really neat business but also a place that God could use me. And I started really excited about it, and I told, like, all of my friends. I'm like, oh, I got this idea. I think God's leading me here. This was, like, 2.5 years into my engineering career, and then I just never did anything. I never took action.
You had, like, a business plan, right?
Yeah, I wrote out, like, a business plan. Yeah. I was coming up with names, you know, so I never took action. And 2 years later, a friend, I was living in Detroit. A friend came out from Chicago who I went to church with when I was here, and he was like, whatever happened to that idea that you had? And I'm like, you know, I just felt like, I felt ashamed, you know, I didn't have the courage to, I said, I'm afraid, I guess, you know, and he said, well, why are you afraid? And I'm like, I just kind of challenged it, and it kind of reignited that passion. That was right before Christmas of 1998, and I said, well, I'm going to just pray, and if I still feel like this is where God wants me to go, I'm going to take action, like, after the Super Bowl. And so I was still in that place, you know, got to put a good marker on it. such a stereotypical jock, but so I waited till the Super Bowl, and then I'm like, okay, I'm gonna take action. I was single at the time. I had a townhouse. I needed to get out from under this mortgage, and I said, well, I need to list my place to sell it, and then I need to find an internship because I was a mechanical engineer. I didn't have the right training to be in the field of strength and conditioning, and so I wound up listing my place, called around. Nobody was interested in a mechanical engineer as a strength and conditioning intern. But I still listed it. When the day that my place went on the market, I was hanging out with a friend. I had to leave, because they were going to show it. And I was telling my buddy, I said, I just feel like a lot of anxiety. And I said, would you pray with me? Because I just felt unsure. And he said, yeah, and we prayed. And it was just this, like, really remarkably powerful time of prayer where God just put his peace in my heart. I went back home. I called the guy who's a head strength coach at Northwestern I'm just going to ask him, like, do I need to get a certification or what? I'm talking to him on the phone. He said, well, the best thing would be for you to come to Northwestern and do an internship with me. And I'm like, really? And, like, while I'm talking to him, he said, but you got to be here by June 1st. I'm on the phone with him, and I get my realtor calls in, said that the people that just looked at your place put an offer on it. They want to be in it by June 1st. Mm. I had a company car in my job, and I knew I was going to have no income, and I was going to need a car, and I was, like, kind of wondering about that. And on Monday, I called my best friend in the company I worked for to let him know I was leaving. And he said, well, brother, you're going to need a car. And so he said, I want you to have my car. Mm. And so, I got the internship. I got a car, a place to live. You know, it was just really this really remarkable time of, like, I think God clearly moving me in a direction. There's a lot of details. It's a very long story. I'm going to try to cut it off. But it was just really encouraging to see, like, as I took the step of listing my place, even though I didn't know what it all looked like, that God kind of, acted, and he laid out the plan. And, like, even at that time, like, a passage that was just still means a lot to me, Proverbs 19:21 says, many are the plans in a man's heart, but it's the Lord's purpose that prevails. And because I didn't know, I had no clarity on what it would eventually look like, and it's neat to look back, but I knew that this was the direction to go, and I just had peace and like submitting to God's moving in my life, and then seeing like time and time again, like throughout my 23 years since I've made that move, to see how God's provided, you know, in so many ways is just a real encouragement. And then it gives me hope as I look to the future. I still don't know what the future holds, but, you know, it's I know that God is with me, and I trust him to provide as he's always provided and he's promised to.
That's great. Thank you so much. Yeah. Really appreciate that, Tommy and Peter. Awesome. And Tommy, actually, he told me, I didn't know this part of the story, but he moved back to Chicago, and that's how him and Shanna ended up reconnecting and got married. That's a really powerful story. So their kids are very thankful that he was obedient, you know, to the Lord's call on his life. And listen, that number is up here. Please take advantage of this opportunity to text in. We just want to be of help to you. And we've got some really great people, great leaders in our church, people who own businesses, who are supervising, and would love to help you and sit with you and coach you on what you can do, some real practical next steps. We've even got people reaching out to us with, hey, there's these this place is hiring, or these jobs are available, and we would love to connect you with some of these great opportunities that are available for us. Well, as we close here, I just want to welcome especially those of you that are new, first-time guests. You know, a couple of you have been visiting for a couple of weeks, and we got something this weekend called Step One. It's for people that are new at the church, and I'd love for you to come and join us. You know, I'm pointing at a couple of them. Yeah, love for you to come and join us and hear a little bit about our church and how to connect with us and our community, and you can see how you can really use your gifts here to grow and mature, even in your relationship with Jesus. So if that's you, you're new, or you want to learn how to connect here, we'd love to have you. Just go out that door right there. It's Mark number one. Pastor Eddie is there. And hang a left. My office is there. And we've got donuts here. We do this every other week. You know, just an opportunity for you to have some fellowship with one another. So just enjoy the rest of your day. Go in the peace of the Lord. God bless you.